Learning to use the TI-84 Plus Silver Edition Calculator. Coming right up! First, we'll learn about fractions and outputting our numbers as fractions. Let's turn the calculator on. And we're going to do 1/3, so 1 divided by 3 plus 1 divided by 5, so 1/3 plus 1/5. Now I want the calculator to output this as a fraction, so I'm going to hit the math key, and then I'm going to choose number 1 here, which that little arrow means output as a fraction, and that puts that command on the home screen. The screen right here is called the home screen, and next when I hit enter, it'll give me my result, which I can now write down, and that is 8/15. Now, how do I input 0.385 as a fraction? Well, 0.385, and I just go through exactly the same procedure. Math, 1 at frac, and that instruction says on the home screen, says output the result as a fraction, and that is, excuse me, that's 77/200. So that's going to be 77/200. So your calculator is really good at doing fractions for you. You don't have to worry about that when you can use your calculator. Next, I want to have the calculator perform the calculation for the base of 27 to the power negative 1/3. 27, I'm going to hit this carré symbol here, and that puts the cursor up into the exponent area, minus 1 divided by 3, and notice it, the cursor is now blinking up in the exponent area. I want it down in the whole numbers area, so I'm going to hit the forward key here, and now I want to tell the calculator output everything as a fraction, so math, hit enter to choose that arrow frac, and then enter the second time to do the calculation, and I see that the result is 1/3. So let's just verify that that is in fact correct. So I know 27 to the negative 1/3. Well, that's just the same as 1 over 27 to the positive 1/3, isn't it? And that, of course, is 1 over the cubed root of 27, and that is 1/3, because 3 to the power 3 is 27. So the it's much easier just to do it on the calculator, of course. Next, I'm going to calculate this fraction, 4 minus 5 all squared over 5 squared minus 4 squared. And I'm going to have to be careful here with my numerator and denominator. So I'm going to use the parentheses key, 4 minus 5, close the parentheses, squared. And now I'm going to use divide. Now, I've got to have everything in the numerator enclosed in parentheses, otherwise it'll use the order of operations and think it's 4 minus 5 squared divided by 5 squared. And that's not what we want, is it? So I have 5 squared minus 4 squared. And I hit enter. Oh, darn, that's right. I needed to output this as a fraction. But that's no problem. I'm just going to say second answer and then tell it to output the answer as a fraction. And I see that my result then is 1/9. So even if I forget, I can get the previous answer back by hitting second answer. And then I can have it output as a fraction. Next, I want to calculate 1 divided by the 4th root of 81. So that's 1 divided by, and now I'm going to have to enter this 4th root of 81. So I'm going to hit 4, and then the math key, and I'm going to need this number 5 here. I can scroll down to 5, or I could hit the 5 key, and that hit enter, and that puts that at the 4th root, because I put 4 first of all, 81. Now notice how my cursor is still underneath the square root. I want to hit this forward button to get out of that, and I want the output as a fraction, and that gives me 1/3, and that, boy, this calculator makes my life easy, doesn't it? Now we're going to turn to graphing. We're going to graph y equals 2x squared minus x minus 3 on the calculator, and by hand, we're going to find the zeros and write the zeros as points. We start off by clicking y equals, and we want to put in 2x squared minus x minus 3. So I want to double check I've put my equation in there correctly. Second quit gets me back to the home screen. Now, in order to see the graph, there's a couple of different things I could do. I could choose to set up the window, or I could have it look at an automatic window. And the automatic window has x going from minus 10 to 10 with a check mark every 1, y going from minus 10 to 10 with a check mark every 1. So I'm going to start with that. We're going to go zoom, and I'm going to select 6 here. And that will graph my parabola. And I can see that I have 2 points there. Now, that's a nice picture, but I'd like to zoom in a little bit. And I think what I'm going to do now, I'm going to go to window, and instead of minus 10 to 10, you can see the standard graphing window there. Let's go, now remember, always use this for the negative key, never use the subtract, minus 5 to 5, and I'll leave the check mark every 1 for the x scale, and minus 5 to 5, and I'll leave a check mark every 1 for the y scale. Then I'm going to hit this graph key. And there I can see a zoom in on my graph. And I can see there's a zero there. It looks about at the point negative 1. And there's a zero there. And I'm going to say that's about 1.5, but I'm not sure. So I want to find these zeros. I'm going to hit second calc. And I'll choose number 2, 0. And what this does, notice at the top here, it's showing me my function, f of x equals 2x squared minus x minus 3, or y equals 2x squared minus x minus 3. And now it's asking me for the left bound. So I'm going to find this 0 here on the negative of the y-axis first. I'm going to scroll backwards. It wants 3 inputs. The left side of the 0, so I'm going to hit enter there. Now I'm going to have to arrow forward to get to the right side of the 0 and hit enter a third time. And notice it says take a guess. I'm going to go back up close to where the 0 is, but not exactly, and hit enter. And I see that the 0 is x equals negative 1, y equals 0. Now let's find the other 0. So second calc. Again, I want to choose 0. And I need the left bound, so I need that a little bit to the left of where I think the 0 is. Then again, I need the right bound, and I read the screen to see what's happening, right bound. And I hit enter, and then I want to take a guess, so I'm going to either use the left or the right arrows to get close. It doesn't have to be exact. And I see my second 0 there is x equals 1.5. So I have x equals 1.5, or 3/2, isn't it? 3/2, 0, because 1.5 is 3/2. And that gives me the two places where the function intersects. Next, I think I want to find the lowest point down here. So what I'll do then is use the calculator menu again, second calc. And this time I want to choose minimum, and I have to go through the same process. I need a left bound, so it's going to take me a little bit to scroll to the left of where I think the lowest point is. Now I want to scroll to the right of where I think the lowest point is. And that is about there. It doesn't have to be perfect. And then let's scroll relatively close to it, and I see the lowest point there is x equals 0.25, I'm going to round off, and y equals minus 3.125. Next, what we want to do is to draw our graph on our graph paper. And I'm going to use the points that I found on my calculator. I'm going to put the zeros in first. So the first zero is x is negative 1. I'll just mark that with a small x value here. And y is, 0. And then again, the next one is 1.50, or x is 3/2 and y is 0. And then for my lowest value here, I know that x is about 1/4 or 0.25 and y is negative 3.125. So this lowest value is down here somewhere. That's my minimum value. I know it looks like a parabola, so I can draw my parabola in through the points that I found. And I also know it looks like a parabola because I've seen it on the calculator. And there's my parabola. I want to graph the function f of x equals 3 minus x. It's a line, of course, so 3 minus x. Second quit gets me back to the home screen, and I'll just see what that looks like on the standard graphing window. Zoom, 6. And I see that that's a negative or a slope or a downward sloping line. I think I'll set my window more exactly to match the window I have here. So I'll go from negative 4 on the lowest x value to positive 4 on the highest. Leave a check mark every one, negative 4 on the y to positive 4 on the highest. And let's have another look at that graph. Okay, now I can clearly see what my graph looks like, but I want to be able to get some xy points and put them on my graph. So I'm going to go to second table set, and I think I'll start at negative 1, and I'll go up by 1. So the table start is your very first or lowest x value, and the delta table, that little triangle there, is a Greek letter delta. That means go up by 1 every time, so it'll be negative 1, 0, 1, 2, etc. I want to leave independent x variables at auto and the dependent y variables at auto. Second table will allow me to see all of the values in the table. And you can see that I have, when x is negative 1, y is 4. So that's the first point I might want to put on my graph. And when x is 0, y is 3. There's another point. So when x is 0, y is 3. And let's just get one more. When x is 3, y is 0. So that's the point 3, 0. And let me just change colors really quickly here. And I'll draw my graph. So my first point, x is negative 1, y is 4. X is 0, y is 3. X is 3, y is 0. And if I wanted to be really careful, I could even put some more in. When x is 1, y is 2. When x is 2, y is 1. And you can see that that pretty much lines up. Well, we'll just pretend I can draw a straight line on the computer. And if I hit graph, I'll see my graph. Next, I want to do these calculations. I have 1 divided by 100,000. And that's going to give me 1 e to the minus 5. And you'll remember that e to the negative 5, that's scientific notation. And because it's negative there, that means take the decimal point, which is in front of the 1, and take it to the left 5 places. So that's 0.00001. I could even check that in this particular case, 00001. And that's going to give me 1 e to the minus 5. So remember, very small and very large numbers are going to be given to you in scientific notation. Now let's do this multiplication. It's going to result in a very large number. So I have 3.5 times 25 to the power 7. Let's just move that out of the exponent area there and hit enter. And now I'm going to get a very large number. So let's just count that. I've got to take the decimal place and move it 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 slots. So that's going to give me the number 2, 1, 0, 5, 7, 1, 2, 8, 9, 1, 0. So if I put a decimal place every 3, that's 21,057,128,910, a very large number. So remember here, when I see this notation, in this case E10, it's positive, and that means to move the decimal place right by 10 units, or whatever comes after the E. Don't forget your scientific notation. I would like to invite you to like this video and subscribe to this channel. Thanks very much for listening.